Hello and welcome to another Overlord video, and this time I will speculate a bit about what should and shouldn't be in Overlord's fourth season. Now, by no means whatsoever I'm trying to tell the author or the studio what to do with their IP, and all I'm doing here is to tell you what I really want to see and why. But before we do so, I say thanks to my Patreons for supporting this channel. Now, what season 4 should have in it and what not depends mainly on the number of episodes. If 24 episodes are available, or even more, then I really would love to see everything animated up until the start of the Holy Kingdom arc. Getting to see how Ainz deals with his first New World Dragon, and how Shaltir redeems herself by dooming others, would be absolutely awesome. Especially because Maruyama's take on the dwarves is very interesting. For example, while they labor in mines like so many dwarves from so many other fantasy universes, they get really sick from it. It's definitely not the most pleasant form of existence. And as mentioned before in my videos, these little things are what makes Overlord's worldbuilding so genuine and believable. Oh, and one neat little detail. Even the women have beards, roughly similar to that of a normal human male with a beard in medieval times, which I have no doubt about would lead to some pretty interesting reaction videos. But if 10 to 13 episodes are all what will be available, then I would really enjoy it if the fourth season is all about a single book, with all of its details, especially because the 10th volume of Overlord has one of the best fighting scenes with Ainz in the entire series, and also the legendary display of obliviousness that directly led to the Empire becoming a vassal state. This would also be a good time to introduce Nigredo and Rubedo, Naruto style. Via flashbacks. Basically all of the scenes with Nigredo could be told from Albedo's perspective, as a little hint that there might be something more about the Floor Guardian Overseer. One most definitely would also need the time to let the Theocracy's High Meeting play out, which in my opinion should be at least one entire episode, since many scenes require a fair bit of time to actually unfold. For example, right at the beginning of the meeting, the highest and some of the oldest members of the slain Theocracy's governing body and military leadership are seen physically working, vacuuming the room, cleaning statues, and just removing every little piece of dust before finally, after the room is cleaned thoroughly, start of the meeting by cleaning themselves and the, by that time, dirty rags they had used for cleaning the entire room, but this time instantaneously and with magic. And this entire scene is, in my opinion, so incredibly important because it shows their humility in front of the six great gods. Despite the very fact that they could just clean the room with magic, they are working physically. This labor is almost a ritualistic act of dedication, and it is in all likelihood meant to remind them to work hard for the greater good of humanity. Especially if we take into account that actually using magic to clean the room would be considered blasphemy. And in the same manner that showing off a bunch of old people sweating and cleaning is important, showing the reaction to the massacre at the Cuts Plain is equally vital. I would expect like a solid 40 seconds of uncomfortable reading, followed by silence and a tense atmosphere, all in an effort to really hammer home the impact Ainz Ulgaun's display of power had made, even on this, as far as New World beings are concerned, knowing and informed people. And scenes like this are everywhere throughout the 10th volume, whether it be the reaction of Einsach Pluton, the introduction of the Martial Champion, all the way to Emperor Jerkniff's delicious shock once he assumes that he had finally unraveled the non-existing plan of Ainz Ulgaun, and thus is now caught right inside his masterfully crafted intrigue. And of course the reaction of the parts of the slain Theoc's council and the temple members that were just discussing plans of betrayal and a grand alliance just a moment ago. The sheer amount of dread, despair, and brutal direct shock, as Ainz Ulgaun had seemingly caught them all red-handed, is something that needs to be displayed in the greatest detail possible. Also, Jerkniff cheering on the Martial Champion like a whole stadium of soccer fanatics, crossbred with Albedo's reaction towards Ainz being hurt, would be absolutely hilarious. This until now very restrained and controlled statesman, going absolutely mad with a desperate sense of hope, followed by the sudden realization that it is all in vain, would be one of the most memorable facial expressions in all of anime. Yes, all of anime. And the same applies for the 11th volume. But with all of that being said, I also want to touch upon something that shouldn't be in it. Bad CG. Don't get me wrong, CG can look fantastic, if it's done like in Sword Art Online, where history not only repeats but indeed fights itself. Whether you have seen the entire series or are just as confused with where to start as Giguk is, I believe that the overwhelming majority of people that watches this video had also watched the battle Archer vs Lancer at some point on a fateful night where you stayed up late, and the YouTube algorithm had taken over the decision making process for you. And again, it is one of the most beautiful animated battle in all of anime. Oh, and by the way, this used to be a dating game, but while CG can look extremely good, it also can be nothing short of an immersion breaker. Enri's Goblin Army and the Dark Young were criticized by many, and that rightfully so. The animations really have taken from the impact of the scene, but I also understand that time pressure and or the need to cut cost is a thing. After all, this was the second season that came out the very year, and therefore they might have run out of time at the end. I mean, the Battle of Momon against Yaldabaoth looked quite well. Same for the Evil Eye vs Yuri Alpha beatdown. And that's also why I would like to get only one season at a time. Because if the Battle Goblin Army against Rias Thais or the Rampage of the Dark Young would have been as good as the Battle of Not Eins against certainly somebody else than Demiurge, I don't believe that there would have been much critique at all. Another thing that shouldn't be in it is characters that should be in it just not appearing. The disappearance of important characters might become a problem. I already have touched upon Nigredos and Rubedos' appearance, and how I believe that these characters are likely super important, and that they were moving towards one of the climactic highlights in all of Overlord, thanks to the Albedo conspiracy. But I also really want to see minor characters interacting with major characters, such as Silver Canary, an adamantite-ranked adventurer team from the Empire of Baharut, which by the way is also a reference to Platinum Dragonlord's namesake in D&D terms, Bahamut, since the Platinum Dragon is said to be always accompanied by 7 canaries, while in human form. And he were also said to dress like a humble peasant. And all of these matching patterns makes me curious what role this adventurer team has yet to play in the City-State Alliance, where they explicitly relocated after the Empire had fallen to Eins. I mean, considering what had come from the mansions of Red Drop during the earlier books, I believe everything is possible with them. And even if nothing of that sort happens, it's still a neat little detail of world building and a great reference. Likewise, the Hikikomori dragon, and the scene where one of the Dwarven Regency Council members flat out steals from Ein Sulgaun, might be very important later in the story. So yeah, these were my thoughts, expectations, hopes and dreams in regards to Overlord's 4th season that will hopefully happen in 2021. And now I'm quite interested in your thoughts, so be sure to leave a comment. And with that said, thank you very much for watching, and special thanks to Adam J, Al Capone, Andy, Angel of Death, Bad Guy E, Boyzilla, Chrissy, Diabetic Centaur, Dystopia, Elika Birchleaf, Phaelis Katus, Thoral Shivan, Gigafight, Ghost of Epicness, Hector Marino, Black Phoenix Emperor, Hoss, Janabi, Jason, Kleinator, Chromius, Large, Lord Nishiken Rai, Lord Touch Me, Lord Ulbert Elaine Odell, Lucas Ollie, Laxus Fox, Majima, Matt, Matt C, Marcos, Mr. Shoes, Mindless Wrath, Minu 13, Mirtis, Nfiria's Potion, Primus 11, Sasuga Einsamer, Sebastian, Shadow Lightning Wolf, Surge, Sparkly Unicorn, The Orc Warboss, Rock Ad Smasher, Vash Hawkeye, Zoggo Bane of a Lord, and Zonagon. Thanks, guys. Anyway, have a nice day. Over and out.